This is the story of the rise and fall of a legendary city and its long hidden legacy of hundreds of thousands of ancient manuscripts. Set against a backdrop of great empires and visionary leaders, it tells how trade routes from the east became ink roads, bringing writing to the heart of West Africa, and how Timbuktu became its leading light, and how invasions and conquest caused that story to be buried literally. Africa's storytellers, guardians of its history, have had their oral traditions dismissed as mere song and dance, and the assumed lack of a literary heritage interpreted as meaning Africa doesn't have its own intellectual traditions. But now a different truth is emerging that tells us the reading and writing of books has been as important a part of life in Africa as it has in Europe. And as Timbuktu's manuscripts are brought out of hiding, the conviction grows that what they have to tell us may forever rewrite Africa's history.
This box looks like it's been buried. It's covered in dirt and things on the bottom. Why was it put under the ground?
Over the years, we have protected the manuscript from those who wanted to take them away. We have over 4,000 manuscripts in our collection.
What's incredible is that I'm in a small village in Mali, in Africa, on the edge of the Sahara Desert. It's about the last place on Earth I'd expect to find manuscripts hundreds of years old. But this is where the search for the lost libraries of Timbuktu really begins.
Europeans dreamed of reaching Timbuktu ever since stories began to circulate in medieval times of a desert El Dorado whose streets were paved with gold. My journey was as mundane as any these days. Several flights and an overnight in Mali's capital Bamako before the last leg to Timbuktu. It wasn't until the 19th century that European explorers set out to survey Africa and to search for the fabled city of Timbuktu. Their journeys across deserts and along rivers took years, led to violent encounters with desert tribesmen and cost lives. So Timbuktu became forever synonymous with remoteness and mystery, the farthest place on earth.
I grew up in Sierra Leone, and I've long known that Timbuktu was in Mali, in the Sahara Desert. But it was only passing through here a few years ago I realised there was much more to Timbuktu than meets the eye. That this seemingly unremarkable desert town was once a splendid city of scholars, and from the 13th century, West Africa's most important seat of learning. In Sierra Leone, I've often heard stories of the Alphas, learned men from the north who travelled south to spread the word of Allah. What I'd never realised before is that many of them would have started out right here, in the deserts of Timbuktu.
Even Africans are just discovering the story of Timbuktu and its lost libraries.
Probably people educated in Arabic and Islam know something about manuscripts, but I don't think that the general public are aware about manuscripts.
I became aware of the existence of the manuscript not longer than 2 years ago.
It sounded like a joke, because my director called me and says, Alexio, you've been requested to go to Timbuktu. Do you know a place called Timbuktu? And I said, no, other than the fact that it's a small, impossible place to get to in Mali, in West Africa.
Until 1960, Mali was a French colony, and French has remained the official language. Only after independence did the custodians of Timbuktu's manuscripts feel it was safe to bring their cultural treasures out of hiding.
This is one of around 30 libraries opened in Timbuktu in recent years. Between them, the libraries have over 70,000 manuscripts.
Timbuktu's libraries are run by families whose ancestors began collecting books and documents 8 centuries ago. The new libraries house whatever remnants of those collections have survived the ravages of time, and their contents offer an invaluable source for a new understanding of West African history. At the Mama Haidara Library, Abdul Kader Haidara has agreed to show me some of his collection, manuscripts on astronomy, medicine and theology, including commentaries on the sayings of the Prophet. These particular manuscripts date from around the 16th and 17th centuries. This one's been nibbled by termites.
This is a really interesting manuscript about astronomy. These are the astronomic drawings showing the position of all stars. I'm not an expert, but that is what they tell us.
Well, they knew more about it then than I do now.
It shows you how to calculate position of the stars using these letters and numbers.
Next, he showed me a 16th century manuscript.
So this is a text of the Prophet's sayings. What's more, there are all these notes in the margin. They can be about anything. But this one talks about hygiene. If you eat something unclean, you will always have problems and complications with your health.
Okay, so you must always wash your food, which is pretty good advice. Mm. And all that was written in the margins by people who came after.
Voilà.
In the past, there were very little papers. They were very expensive. So the margins of books were often used just like today when we use a diary. I saw one example where the writer said, "Today, there was an earthquake in Timbuktu."
And here's a 500-year-old recipe for toothpaste.
You take some salt and some sugar and mix that together with some charcoal and brush it on your teeth every day, and your teeth will become white. And what's more, it will get rid of your bad breath.
So how did the libraries first come into being? How were they lost? And how will their discovery alter perceptions of Africa? At the end of the 10th century, when Timbuktu was founded, a large part of West Africa was under the rule of the Ghana Empire. It was West Africa's first superpower, and its leaders were early converts to Islam. The spread of Islam was the compelling factor that changed history here and gave Africa its literary tradition.
Islam spread from the Arabian Peninsula, from Egypt, and then along the coast of North Africa. But some other Muslims came from the north, the ones who founded Timbuktu, and being traders, spread Islam from the Sahara to the south coast.
Just as in Europe, where most early manuscripts were religious works written in Latin, in Timbuktu the bulk of the texts are written in Arabic and concern Islamic theology. The Ahmed Baba Institute, the only public library, holds Mali's national collection. Set up in 1973, it now has over 40,000 manuscripts. The head librarian told me just how many turn up on a weekly basis. It's an impressive number.
Every week we get about 700.
600 or 700 a week?
Yes, per week. So when the manuscripts arrive here, the first thing we have to do is evaluate them to see what conditions they are in. We pick out all the best ones, but the ones that are too damaged, we put to one side. For me, my favorite ones are the ones in the African languages, but written with Arabic characters. They are called Ajami texts. Because I'm Sorai, when I see a manuscript in Sorai, it makes me happy. You have some manuscripts in